Space Dandy is a dandy guy in space. He combs the galaxy like his pompadour on the hunt for aliens. Planet after planet, he searches for bizarre new creatures, both friendly and not. These are the spectacular tales of Space Dandy and his brave space crew in space. Bump.
Hello and welcome to Shred Cells episode 59. I am your host Alex Schmitz, and with me here today with that awesome opening is Matthew Scotty Lund.
Hello.
Tristan Wayne.
I'm here.
And Jeremy Zajac.
I may not actually be here.
Oh my, he's a phantom. Yes, and you might be a little surprised to hear our voices, because on the last podcast on No Game No Life, we talked about how we're going to do Code Geass, and we are still doing that. But the finale of Space Dandy aired this past Saturday, and we were all so enamored by it and have been watching the show throughout its airing that we decided we wanted to do this episode on Space Dandy, because it's a great show.
Before you can get your lunch, you must have your space breakfast.
Indeed. But before we get into that, we'll talk about a little bit of news that's come out in the past week. One thing I saw is that the Psycho Pass, which is getting a second season here soon, is also getting a movie coming out January 9th and is apparently being written by Gannon Urobuchi, the original writer of the first show. So that's got me pretty excited. Matt, are you getting excited for Psycho Pass season 2?
I mean, I need to watch it, but the fact that it's going to be a Funimation thing and, like, I don't have Funimation access means I'm going to have to find a way to watch it, you know, through other means.
Gasp.
So, impossible. If it ain't on Crunchyroll, which I pay for, then it doesn't hit my radar.
Well, you can only pay for so many subscriptions at a time.
I gotta buy all the subscriptions. All the anime.
So out of curiosity, who's doing the animations for the movie?
That's a good question.
Is it IG, or because they're not doing the second season?
I don't know if they announced that. I'm gonna guess it's IG, but I'm not positive.
Not positive.
Other thing, Tokyo Ghoul was announced that it's getting a season 2 in January, I believe. So that's a show I enjoyed that aired.
So everybody with
season.
The cannibalism boners can continue getting that.
Oh boy!
Oh yes, all the suffering. Everyone loves that. I don't know if anyone else saw this, because apparently Jeremy didn't, but there was a trailer for Inside Out today, the new Pixar film. Did anyone see that besides me?
Nope. I did not. I heard you talking about it earlier, but besides that, it's all I know besides same guys as Up.
Yes,
is.
It's directed by Pete Docter, who directed Up and Monsters Incorporated, and it's about the emotions inside a little girl's head, basically. So it's like anger, happiness, sadness, fear, all like characters.
I am willing to give it a chance. But after their last two or three movies, Pixar has been on kind of a cold streak.
Granted, this is their first one coming out of, like, original ideas. Everything they've been kind of churning out lately is
Brave.
Less we talk about Brave, the better.
I haven't even seen Brave, just to put an impact on it.
Like, unlike the others, it didn't really net me right away. It went on a sequelitis streak. So
here's my thing with Brave. I'm going to give you the long and short of Brave. Brave is a bad Pixar movie. However, it is a good Disney princess movie. What we were promised is not what we received. We were promised it's an action-adventure movie. We got Brother Bear.
And it seems I know that there was a lot of changing of directors behind the scenes with that movie, so yep. I feel like some of that led to it being kind of an unfocused movie.
But again, let's be honest here, it was not a very
good... It was not very good. I would argue that...
But is it better than Cars?
Cars 1, no. Cars 2, yes.
Yeah. I would argue, though, that
better than Cars 2.
I genuinely enjoyed Monsters University. Like, it wasn't anything special, but it was...
Again, I still haven't seen that either, because it's nothing special.
Monsters University is worth seeing. I wouldn't necessarily recommend Brave.
It's above average. The problem is, though, Pixar has been in kind of a slump, and it's starting to make me worried.
Well, you know, you think that's a slump. Wait till The Incredibles 2. I mean, I know you're like, my body is ready for that. But
it's being
unlike the others, Incredibles.
It's being done by Brad Bird, though.
But Incredibles is also a concept that could get a sequel.
And
unlike the others that were just kind of like Cars 2, okay, Monsters University.
Well, really? We're also getting Cars 3 now because,
you know, I keep getting told it sells
the toys.
Merchandise.
It does.
Part of me doesn't believe that, though.
Well,
a small part of me honestly.
I mean, they made a
no
crappy
Rangers,
Planes movie, Fire and Rescue.
That was not Pixar. That was
Disney's Toon Studio or whatever.
And if memory serves right, that movie was a critical and commercial flop, well, just like the first one.
I don't know about the first one. I know for a fact the second one didn't do well even commercially.
Hey, now, if they want to make a Trains movie,
don't give them ideas.
Listen, well, Disney, listen.
Matthew would be all
well,
over that.
On that note.
Yeah, and I was just going to say, Incredibles 2 is being written by Brad Bird. We don't know if he's coming back to direct it because he's been going in more of a live-action route recently because he did Mission Impossible 5, I think.
Which I started.
Ghost
seen.
Protocol.
It's all right. Oh,
it's pretty good.
Oh, Ghost Protocol. I saw Ghost Protocol.
Was is that Mission Impossible 5?
That
or
was
am I
four.
Messing that up? Okay, whatever. He did Ghost Protocol. Last piece of
on.
News is that Threshold Entertainment, the wonderful makers of Food Fight, are making a Tetris movie.
Jeremy continues his week 5 of Suicide Watch.
Apparently, they made a Mortal Kombat movie back in 1995.
Which one? Was it Annihilation or was it the first one?
They made both.
The first one is an okay movie. It's not bad. It's kind of hokey. It's kind of fun to watch.
But
the second one is like an unnecessary root canal.
Okay, well, yeah, that's the same people who made Food Fight also made those.
And interesting. So they made, this is the live action movies, not animated Mortal Kombat movies.
No, these are live action.
Okay. Yeah, interesting.
Okay.
I didn't know
they are animated Mortal Kombat movies, but let's not speak of those.
All right. And let's also just talk about animation we've watched since last time. For me, that'll just be things
actually,
I've watched.
Actually, you didn't say what Threshold Studios was doing.
Tetris. I said that.
No, you didn't.
No, you did not say anything about Tetris.
Well, I absolutely
that's what
did.
They're doing.
I absolutely did, but I'll reiterate it. They're making a Tetris movie, apparently.
We exist just to make Alex upset, just a heads up.
Thankfully, there is audio, and you can go back and listen to hear me say the word Tetris.
Are you really going to come back through the
audio? Did you say, that was my voice censored.
There we go.
If you're hearing this, then that means that Alex has not gone through the audio and blocked out my voice.
We're not dead yet.
Yes, I won't block you out, Tristan. I'll just make you very quiet.
But like I've said, I feel partially responsible for the Universal deal with Threshold because of how many people I've shown Food Fight.
It's our world.
It's kind of sad.
It's our life.
With stuff like how The Room is actually kind of popular because of how bad it is.
Yeah, but Tommy Wiseau didn't really get any work after The Room. This is a stark difference.
Actually,
this
he is making something. I showed you.
Well,
the,
it's independent, though.
True.
It's independent. It's not Hollywood saying, that was a fantastic movie. Come make it more.
Yeah.
Right. No.
That's what they did.
Moving on, anyways. Animation we've watched since last time. Basically, anything you've been watching recently. I watched the first episode of Terraformers, which is a new the new fall anime. Yeah, it was all
racist
right.
Cockroaches.
Apparently. I watched a couple episodes of Panty and Stocking, Pet Girl of Sakuraso at J-Con, Cowboy Bebop, Code Geass, and I finished Lovely Complex, like a funny rom-com show that was pretty good overall. Tristan, what have you been watching?
Well, everything as a result of J-Con. Did you not see any in Origami?
I missed, that was weeks ago. I missed a couple showings. And yeah, I've seen some Origami before.
Well, I guess Origami was one of them. I rewatched Fanny and Stocking as a result. A few episodes here and there of Cowboy Bebop. And, well, that bulk of Code Geass that we all watched.
Yes.
Ladouche of the Rebellion.
Episode
tables! Lots of tables!
Let's not bring up the table.
For those,
I think we should be a little classier.
For those who have, yeah, well, and we're not supposed to swear and stuff on this podcast, but for those of you who have not seen Code Geass in a while, go rewatch episode 12 if you want to be reminded of a certain character's craziness.
Yeah.
Hey, you stop that over there. I see what you're doing at the table.
I'm going to put it this way. Alex, who absolutely loves the show, cannot for the life of him find a good way to defend that scene.
Oh, no.
He absolutely refuses to defend that scene.
Is the table waterproof? All right, moving on. Matt, what anime show have you watched since last time?
I've been watching a lot of Hunter x Hunter. Now that it's been capped at 148 episodes, even before then, I started that
last year.
During the springtime.
Oh, I remember that.
During spring, or like March-ish
last
or whatever.
School year, I should say.
I'm only about 50 episodes in, but I'm in one of the best story arcs like that I've enjoyed. I guess the biggest thing, because there was an old Hunter x Hunter TV show that was, I never really heard of it until I heard of the new one. This one's more faithful to the manga. It does do its fair share of dark moments, and that's what I really like. Even though it's pretty happy on the surface, it does have some really, like, oh, those kind of moments.
And copious amounts of clown faces.
Yes, clowns.
Clown
Hisoka.
Rape faces.
Yes. Hisoka.
We should clarify that. If you have a phobia of clowns, like a serious one,
this is
don't
not.
Watch
no,
it.
No, no, no. This would not be. If you don't like clowns, I would not recommend.
By episode 20, I have developed a mild fear of clowns myself.
But the show itself, I enjoy it a lot. It's not like, you know, there's no filler because it's strictly adapting the manga, and it doesn't do the One Piece filler of let's go do something. I'm pretty sure, but it's enjoyable. I like it. I know I got Jeremy watching it a little bit.
I've heard it's one of the better, like, long running shonen shows, especially in the fact that it keeps up its animation quality.
The thing is,
it's probably a tighter production since this is the second animation.
It's a lot tighter, and it's also Studio Madhouse doing it, so the visuals look pretty nice. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, it's just refreshing because it's an older style of anime. It's not. It has a 90s look to it, and I personally enjoy that. I appreciate that it looks older than it really is, and it has beautiful visuals, and I mm-hmm. like the opening credits and stuff. It's no complaints. It's a fun, enjoyable show. There are creepy clown character, but overall, they've got an ending for it. It's not a complete ending, but it's enough for you to say, I witnessed the journey of these characters, and I enjoyed myself. So
now all I need is my Kinnikuman remake, and I'll just be happy.
Never.
All right, Jeremy. Never.
Wrestling is
well, good. Recently, I have started, of course, like Space Dandy, like everyone else, but aside from that, I started rewatching Akagi.
Nice.
I need to watch that, actually.
Are we going
to
finish that eventually?
Yes. Yes, you just need to come over to my house
just
one weekend.
Pick a date.
Okay, fine.
Hail yourself on his nose.
what else have I been doing? I've been watching JoJo's.
Star's Crusaders are the earlier.
Earlier stuff.
The earlier stuff.
See, speaking of things that have an older style.
Well, JoJo. Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm still chugging through that, too. Like, I maybe watched a grand total of 6 episodes of JoJo this entire summer.
It's not that we don't like it. In fact, we love the show. The problem is, you've got to sit down. It's a really good show, but it's a show that you got to sit down and digest.
A little bit. I mean, I enjoy an episode thoroughly, and I'm like, wow. And then I just, personally, I'm busy. I work 30 hours a week. I've got school. I don't have time.
I could feel you on that. Over the summer, I was working at least 40 hours a week every night.
Yeah, even when I did manage to sit down, sometimes I just want to feel like pulling something up. I just be like, I'm going to stare into internet space.
Not yet.
Please don't.
All right. So now we'll move on to the main topic for this week, which, as you could tell by the opening and the title of the podcast, is Space Dandy.
Space Dandy.
A 2014 show done by Studio Bones.
It's Space Dandy.
Chief... Shinichiro Watanabe is the chief director, and the director is Shingo Natsume. But then every episode, the episode directors change almost every episode, as do the writers and most of the creative staff. So this is a show that really is like an ensemble of different creative people working on one project.
You should also mention, too, this was one of the first few simulcasts that the premiered in the United States before the Japanese broadcast, and there's only a handful of shows that you can actually say that have done this.
Right.
Another one would be Toonami's own IGPX back in like 2006 or something.
Right, it aired on Toonami before it actually aired in Japan. One question I had for you, actually, Matt, because you might know this, is because Space Dandy obviously has a pretty large budget given just the amount of animation it uses in its episodes. I was wondering, do you think they got more money than your average anime partially because of like that deal with Toonami and airing in the U.S.?
Most of the stuff that worked through Toonami, Watanabe really just wanted to see this on broadcast TV. Watanabe doesn't really know what, Toonami, I wouldn't say he knows exactly what that is, but he knew it was going to be a fit for American television people. And obviously, the only place that's really running, you know, late night anime, that would be Adult Swim. And to do that, they originally contacted Funimation because they're the distributor. And then Funimation's kind of the one who went to the people over at Adult Swim. And that's how the deal kind of struck. It was a lot of check marks in the right area and a lot of things working out. And this normally doesn't happen because, first of all, the Japanese wanted to air it in the United States before Japan. How many times? Not often. You can't count that many times.
Because so, Japan doesn't usually care about international markets.
No, it really doesn't. So, I mean, granted, they've hinted that there could be a Space Dandy movie, but the only reason you'd primarily get that is the same reason you got, like, Cowboy Bebop the movie or Escaflowne the movie, is because internationally the series was well received. It didn't get received very well in Japan, but international audiences will take it.
Well, going back to something else you said a little earlier about the Funimation thing, I had to say I was shocked more than anything else by the fact that it was actually a very good Funimation dub.
Yes, it's very good.
I was shocked because more often than not, I usually end up hating about half the voices in any given Funimation dub.
Well, I mean, the other thing I would look at is like you could easily compare like what they're doing. Like I originally liked the One Piece dub cast that Funimation has done, but when you listen to like what they're doing with the Enies Lobby arc, it really feels like it's a line delivered. And there's just someone will say a line, and then, you know, like if there's not anything after it, it just feels really fake. Like, I don't know how else to say that other than like it's basically dialogue has been inserted and it just doesn't have much life. It's like I'm reading into a microphone. How dare you do that, Luffy? Like, and then you just say you're done. Like,
and then there's a pause, and then I love giraffes.
I don't know. I just, the point is, I will agree. You do have some Funimation dub stinkers. I don't really watch much Funimation stuff anymore because I'm not really collecting it as much. So I don't see as many Funimation dubs anymore. But I will give hands off that Space Dandy was a very well very good dubbed.
Yeah, I will say with Funimation, I feel like when you watch some of their stuff that they aren't as confident in, you start just hearing the Funimation voice actors that you've come to hear in 10,000 dubs.
Sometimes they do new voice actors too that don't have any very little experience, so it's not as good performance.
Right. Although, but then occasionally you get someone new who does a really good job. I think they do put a lot of effort into their flagship shows, like, you know, Attack on Titan or Space Dandy.
I don't know. I don't know. I felt like the Attack on Titan dub was kind of iffy at points, but neither here nor there. Speaking of the Space Dandy dub, though, bad that I brought it up.
There's only one person in the vocal cast that I would actually complain about, and that would be Scarlet's voice.
Oh, Colleen Klinkenbeard?
I've never been a fan of Colleen Klinkenbeard. Whenever she opens her mouth in a Funimation dub, it's like, it's Colleen Klinkenbeard. But, I mean, I had the same problem back in the day when Laura Bailey was doing all the voices for, like, Kodacha and other series. So, it's just, she can't change her voice. It sounds the same line over and over and over and over and over.
Well, let's go to the most fitting voice cast. Johnny Ong Bosch playing Johnny.
Yes.
Like
Johnny.
I think we all agreed, though, that he's been waiting his entire voice acting, probably his whole life, to be able to deliver that line like that.
Oh, I was Johnny.
Yeah, and I will say the main trio, Dandy is voiced by Ian Sinclair, QT is voiced by Allison Victorin, and
what's she done?
No idea. And
Meow.
Meow is voiced by Joel McDonald. So that's like the main three. And Ian Sinclair in particular, I think, does a really good job.
As much as I like Sinclair, he does a fantastic job. I honestly think, I can't think of whoever his name is. The one who voices Dr. Jell is probably
that's
the best.
That's J. Michael Tatum.
Yeah, he does the best. I think he does the absolute best in the whole
Tatum's
show.
One of the best anime voice actors out there, period.
Oh, yeah, he did Okabe from Steins Gate. But, I mean, just Dr. Jell and the whole show itself, I don't know, like, I like it.
You know, if I had to go through some of my favorite lines, they'd probably all come from Dr. Jell.
Yeah.
I'll chase you, Dandy, to infinity and beyond.
Hey there, sexy!
And apparently the narrator is R. Bruce Elliott. I don't know what else he's done, but he's got a great narrator voice.
With how the end, I guess here's the thing, are we going to be spoiler-free with this because it's new, or are we
We always spoil everything, but we will give a spoiler warning maybe before we talk about the finale.
I will say, most of the time when you have something air on Toonami, as far as like the trailer for the next episode, it's usually their main person they do to read all the, you know, the Toonami whatever promos for whatever it is, whatever new series. I can't think of his name, but it's
Deep Voice Toonami guy.
He replaced Peter Cullen for
unfortunately.
Yeah, but my point is, they had him do all the
Space
preview,
Dandy bumps.
Space Dandy bumps, exactly. Mm-hmm. Even like the promo for the thing, and that's a Funimation voice actor. So I'm like, just with how we know as the last episode goes, I'm really happy that the narrator also did the advertisement for the show, if that makes sense. I don't know.
He permeates everything, basically.
He permeates everything about the show, and I like that, just because the events that happen in episode 26.
Yeah.
So if Space Dandy were able to get a new season or a new movie, it'd be interesting if he's just silent, or it's done by a different person, or silent at all because of the events that happened in 26.
That would be
I don't
interesting.
Know.
Mm-hmm. One thing I want to talk about to start with, I think is a good place to start, is the first episode, because honestly, I know the reaction of the first episode, like when it aired, was a little mixed, because I watched it, you know, when it aired for the first time on Toonami earlier this year. And honestly, like, looking back on it, like having now watched the whole show, like the first episode is pretty fun to watch. But near the beginning, when he's talking about, you know, how he likes, you know, booty more than boobies and all this sort of stuff, it doesn't give the best first impression of what the show is going to be.
Oh, no, I think it gives you exactly the impression that you need from the show. The thing is, this is a space opera thing, the likes of, it's parodying pretty much all of the space tropes that have been out there. A lot of the main character in sci-fi shows generally is pretty big ladies man and everything like that. So whenever you bring up, like,
it's
ladies men...
It's also where you're getting your budget to get the Japanese viewers to watch, because they won't watch it without the
fan
boobies.
Service.
That's racist!
No, I wouldn't, I wouldn't say that, because to an extent, I'm pretty sure the animators are just as happy to draw it as the fans are to watch it. I'm sorry. Like, I'm not.
Oh, yeah,
gonna...
there's a lot of visual cues that the illustrators do that, you know, are good for laughs. There's a particular one where I noticed one of the alien designs in the zombie episode.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of questionable. It's it's clearly the it's like two legs and a butt, but the butt is where the mouth is, and it's just like wow, and it's got
well,
a little. Dribble, it's just like, ugh!
Going back to Dandy's introduction, it didn't bother me because it's one thing to actually put boobies on the screen. It's another thing to just have a character talking about it.
Yeah, well, it's basically his entire reason for living, as you learn.
Yeah, I know, but
yeah.
I'll take that more in a comedy series than a series that takes itself seriously.
But the first episode had generally set the what the show was going to be about. The fact that they all die in the first episode. And then, you know, it's going to continue. It just sets the premise of, we're not taking this seriously. These are going to be, have fun with it. And not until you realize at the very end that all these different episodes are, there's a reason for that and why they're so separate and why they come back. It's not just this, originally a lot of people thought when the series was going is that you had a timeline and then instantly when that dandy would die or whatever, you would shift to a new timeline and it would continue. And then when a character would die, you keep shifting.
Timelines.
The world lines keep changing.
Yeah, and this ain't Steins Gate, though.
And I do agree with you. I think it was actually probably pretty important that they show them dying in the first episode because... It established that, you know, there is no permeance when it comes to that sort of thing. And when I was rewatching it, I noticed they talked about the Pionium and the cosmic string and things like that that kind of showed up again near the end.
Well, even the fact that the whole conversation that he has with QT at the very beginning, that's looped back at the very end of the episode, at the end of the series.
Well,
except that it's changed. Instead of talking about booty, it's about legs.
Well, and actually, and he says something similar at the beginning of the second episode, except he says boobies are the best thing, and QT says, I thought last episode you said it was booty.
And that's the other thing that I really like is that it doesn't take itself seriously to the point where they can say, hey, I thought you said this, even though they're not supposed to.
Yeah, and there's a part where like the narrator is really phoning it in, and he's talking about the Gogol Empire fighting the Jycro Empire, and Dandy's like, I wish I had that guy's job. He's just, you know, not
Which
doing any work.
It's ironic, because in the end...
Yeah.
But that's another thing. Obviously, we have the Gogol Empire, which is Google, you know.
Gogol Street Map.
Yes, not very well hidden there.
Gogol it, you asshole.
Although it took me a while to figure it out, actually. But
really?
Really?
Yeah, really.
It's called Gogol.
I don't know.
And like the third episode, if I'm not mistaken, that was where they made the comment about Gogol. No, it was the second episode was about Gogol Street View, wasn't
it? Yep.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know. I must have missed that line when I was first watching because I watched it like on Toonami at least at first when I was at home and stuff. But let's dive into just talking about I think both our favorite episodes of the show and our least favorite episodes of the show because. Since Dandy is such an episodic series, it really lives and dies from episode to episode. So why don't we start with some of our favorite episodes, not including the finale, because I think all of us like the finale, before we move on to our least favorite episodes of the show.
Oh, yeah. The finale is definitely, I would say, everyone's favorite. And there's a good reason for that. But
yeah. One I wanted to talk about was the zombie episode in episode 4, because I think that was the first really great episode of Dandy. And I think early on in the show, it was important to have an episode that was that good in order to you know, get people excited about the show. Because the first three episodes are fine, but there wasn't anything that amazing in them. You know?
I mean, I like the second episode, the ramen.
Yeah, the ramen.
And the third episode, which has the booby monster, it didn't really... I mean, it's okay.
I think they carried what they need to. I do have a special... Yeah. There is a special place in my heart for the ramen episode, though. I couldn't tell you why, though. I think it's because... wait, was it this episode or a later one? I think it's a later one where they're going through... They're going through, like, a interstellar space mall or something like that with a lot of the restaurants, but it's not really, like, cohesive what restaurants they're in. You just kind of see all of the signs in the back.
Oh, I think you're right, because that's, like, when they're going through and Meow is twittering, and they're just going from place to place,
I don't know if that
maybe.
Was a ramen episode.
That's the ramen episode.
Was it? Okay, yeah. I was thinking it might have been early into fish episode. The other fish episode, not that fish episode.
We have to determine between fish episodes. That gives you an idea of this show. But my favorites, personally, were the zombie episode, the high school episode, the one where Dandy was dead, and the one where QT fell in love. Personally, though, if I had to name like my favorites, those are mine.
I'd have to say if I had any, I really have to agree with Jeremy. I really like, I guess it's, I was wrong about that, Jeremy. It's episode 11, which is the library episode.
Really? That's interesting.
I gave that a rewatch today. I really liked that episode. There's Always Tomorrow, Baby, episode 10 with Meow.
That's actually
the Groundhog Day episode.
Yeah, same here.
That's
Groundhog Day.
That's another good one.
I know Jeremy doesn't care about the Chameleonian episode, but when we watched that,
we were hysterical during that one.
So, and then, you know, to pick a few from season 2, because season 2 was generally, you know...
Better.
I think it was more consistent. I like the Viva All part of the high school episode, but the first song is just, it's not there.
I don't know. It's not as good, but I just liked it because the way I described it to people was basically it was High School Musical, the anime, except good. And it was just awesome. I did theater in high school. I like stuff like that when it's done well. I will admit, the girl who played the Queen Bee, there was something about her singing voice that didn't quite sit right with me. I don't know what it was about it, but she was a little
off. It should be mentioned to know that both Jeremy and Tristan haven't seen the entire series, but they've seen a majority of the episodes, and most of the good ones, too.
Yeah.
Tristan really has not seen the pants...
I haven't
or the
seen,
plants.
Yeah, I haven't seen the pants.
Or the plants.
The pants or the plants.
You're offending the letter P.
Yeah.
Jeez. Well, there was also the episode with where they're trying to catch the fish.
Oh yeah,
that was the first time I saw that one. So I think there may have been a few others that I missed. I could not.
Oh, you're talking about the one with the it starts with an M,
the Munagi.
Yeah.
Meh.
Yeah, that one was just okay to me. When I rewatched it, actually, because originally I thought I kind of hated that episode, but rewatching it was actually pretty good.
Animation wise, but it's.
Yeah, well, fun fact. Can I see this real quick?
Well.
The Munagi episode was directed by a guy named, and I'm going to get his name here, Kiyotaka Oshiyama. Not only did he direct the episode, he wrote it, storyboarded it, and I think he did a majority of key animation in it as well. So, like, it was basically a one-man episode. And knowing that, like, it's more impressive because it is kind of, like, off-model. But when you realize it was all done by one guy and I was kind of going for a certain style, it makes more sense.
I guess another episode of mine, too, was probably Johnny's introduction, the Rock and Roll Dandy Baby.
Let me talk a little bit.
Okay, go ahead.
Because I was just going to say the Rock and Roll Dandy Baby. Rock and Roll Dandy, the Groundhog Day episode. I actually really did like the Space Race episode.
Yeah, that one's fun, especially with how it ends with Dandy becoming Buddha.
What about? Did you see the one with the fish and he was on
a
different planet?
The flash.
They had the flashlight, and when you would shine it on a part of your whatever, it would teleport it.
That one definitely had a really strange tone to it, but
it was still fun.
Yeah,
and I enjoyed it.
The animation was strange and everything, but I liked it.
Yeah,
that was Slow and Steady Wins the Race, Baby.
Yep.
Episode 16.
Yeah, and that's the one directed by Masaki Yuasa, who's the guy who did Eccentric Family and Tatami Galaxy.
Yeah, I'm a fan of his.
Yeah, he's a very kind of famous director.
The problem that I've noticed with a lot of his works is if he's given in charge of the writing and such in a lot of things, he loses, he doesn't, he
Although,
can't keep it.
Actually, he wrote that episode.
Oh, I know, but I'm saying like in a series. If he writes a series, he has a hard time keeping what he wants to do. He gets artsy fartsy with it.
I guess to a lesser extent, I liked the puppet episode.
Yeah, I like that one too. There's music in the darkest, baby.
Especially mostly the last part where he's going through the stream of time.
I agree that the stream
also for giving me a role of Bryce Papenbrook that I can actually stand.
I agree that the part with the stream of time was cool. That episode was just more okay for me because I don't know. It was serious, but it was weird and serious.
It was a good balance. You already know my opinion on the more really serious episodes of Dandy.
Yeah. You're not a fan of them. You prefer silly Dandy. I mean, they're a nice change in pace. I mean, granted, it is... When they probably pitched these to directors, they didn't say, be really silly, you know, do whatever you want with it. Most of them took it in a silly direction, and that's why Space Dandy became this silly kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But those other serious episodes... You'll notice, there's not really a lot of comedy in them at all. Like, they are pretty straight and narrow to the point.
Well, even if Dandy himself is silly.
Like, I noticed, another one of my episodes I didn't include in my list, but I really did like it, was the one that focused on Scarlet and Dandy. And that did have a silly moment where his boyfriend came back in the giant robot, you know, and they got into a fight.
That was one I didn't see, unfortunately.
Oh, you would love it.
I know, add the giant robot.
But then,
everything.
At the end, it had that long musical montage of, you know, Dandy coming back for Scarlet, like, to find her, you know, and that felt very Bebop-esque to me, like,
a
with the music montage
bit.
Sort of thing.
Jeremy, what was your highlights of the series?
Matt already stole my thunder, so...
I know you're excited, man.
Let me hump that table again.
Like the library episode and the,
yeah.
And the
well,
time
I
loop.
Agree with Jeremy. You know, his favorite episodes are, thanks, Matt. I love getting a word in edgewise.
I have to say, because I rewatched the library episode the other day, and I do like it for like the visuals. And
I missed the whole part where it was literally Dandy with a brown paper bag over his head stealing the book from Perry's. I missed that part.
How could we forget the episode where there's a bunch of multidimensional dandies?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's the first episode of season 2.
How the heck could we forget that one?
Yeah, it's a very silly one. And apparently I read that a lot of those were actual character designs from the earlier part of the show, so that's what Dandy could have looked like.
Would not surprise me. I need emo dandies.
What about the female? The one that was kind of alarming was the female meow.
Oh, yeah. If you pay attention, getting a little risque here. If you pay attention, in her first appearance, she has a suspicious white liquid on her face.
Oh,
and
my.
It's on her back leg, too.
Yeah.
And the way she's holding that, it's... The animators had fun with that one, Jeremy.
Yeah. But with the library episode, when I was rewatching it, the part that sort of didn't quite get me is the punchline, basically at the very end, where they open the box and there's a VHS tape, and he talks about how that started a war, that destroyed the whole galaxy. It just sort of
it's like the console wars. It's the disc wars. It's the format wars.
Yeah, I know, but it's just like all the formats had a war and only one remained.
Well, but then and nobody remembered the war because they erased your memory.
Yeah.
I don't know. It just seemed like kind of a strange ending. I didn't think it tied into the rest of the episode.
Strange endings and Dandy. It's not like
never
that's
had that
entire
before.
Point.
I'll agree with you, Alex, a little bit. Like, I rewatched that episode today, and it's a kind of like, I liked it more when I first saw the episode, but it's like, okay, you're explaining a phenomenon that, I mean, media wars have happened, and Jeremy's dancing. I'm sorry, Jeremy.
Of course he's dancing.
Jerry wants some chocolate then.
And I'll also say that going off of what you were saying earlier, what does everyone think about the fact that Dandy basically balances these silly episodes with the dramatic ones? Because obviously I know for you, Tristan, you didn't tend to like the serious ones as much.
Honestly, I'm not gonna be a mean guy here and say that there were too many serious episodes, because the entire series skewed more towards the weird and silly than it did the serious. But definitely the serious episodes, the only reason I'm probably going to come down on those is because I haven't seen the pants or the plants, which are considered by most to be down.
Well, the pants isn't silly.
Yeah. Well, the pants isn't silly.
No, I mean, they're not serious, though.
Yeah, I know, but that doesn't mean they can't fall flat.
The plants one is kind of serious.
Yeah.
I guess we could segue into the least favorite episodes. For me, the least favorite episodes were the Dead World episode, the Lolly episode, and the high school episode.
All right, well, I'm pretty sure I can speak for everyone else here, but I'll let them say it too. Our least favorite episode was episode 6.
Yes,
the
pants episode.
The vesties or whatever it was.
Yeah.
I'm, out of all, that was the episode of Dandy that was honestly to me was the nightmare. That was just like, wow, holy crap, was that bad.
Yeah, and I rewatched it the other day, and it wasn't as bad as I remembered it, but their voices, because they talk in like this broken Yoda kind of speak thing, it really gets on your nerves after a while. The only redeemable part about that episode being the end, that where he surfs in space, which was animated by Hironori Tanaka, who's a famous animator. He did a really good job with that sequence. So that was really good, but the rest of the episode was pretty bad.
And like we've said before, a two-minute scene will not save 22, otherwise 20 minutes of crap.
Right.
Doesn't matter how much you polish the turd, it's still a turd.
Yeah. And I know it sounds like Matt and Jeremy, you guys might disagree with me, but episode 8, which was the one with the dog, I'm not going to say it was a bad episode, but I don't feel like it worked as well as it maybe could have, because I didn't get that sad when the dog died, because it had only built up for half an episode, and then we changed gears completely to like this flea comedy thing where he takes over QT's body and such. I know, it just sort of felt like two episodes smashed together when they didn't need to be there, when they might have worked better as just standalone episodes.
I wouldn't say they stand alone, because they were basically two episodes that, if you would stretch them out to full episodes, they probably wouldn't have held up as long. Like, held up nearly as well.
Maybe.
It is a very dramatic cut, and I'd be curious to see, like, is that two people working on it, or is it just one person?
It was just one guy. And when I was rewatching that episode, they show shots of the fleas on the dog's like fur throughout the first half of the episode.
It's different. It's just a different style of trying to tell a story. You know, I'm not going to say it's a great way to do it, but I do like that episode. One, because we get the Cowboy Bebop reference, the fridge with the squirmy food in it, which is from Cowboy Bebop.
I actually saw that episode.
That cool. Yeah, that's in that episode.
And the fact that all the money in the show is Wulongs is also kind of a reference to Bebop.
Well, I guess going back to the low points for me, I'm sorry, Alex, I know you like the high school, but to me, all of it sounded awkward to me, even Viva Vo.
And you're allowed to think that.
I know there's a reason why it's awkward, because of the amount of time they had to dub it, but if it's bad, it's bad, and I'm sorry.
Well, I will say this, because I was kind of curious, because I wanted to see the episode in Japanese to see it lip-sync a little better, because I will admit there were some points where it got a little off, but you can sort of understand it because it's English-Japanese. I will say Funimation did a great job of translating the lyrics, because it was pretty much the exact same words they were saying in the sub that they said in the dub. So I give them props for that. And Ian Sinclair's Space Dandy singing actually sounded a lot better than I thought he would. I was actually genuinely impressed with that.
Yeah. With the Lolly episode, it just really felt out of the Lolly and Planet episode. I both kind of have the same things, in which somewhat affection taken seriously in Dandy.
Yeah, well,
and the one with the Planet thing is that it looks very pretty. I'll give it this one. It looks pretty, and the environments is pretty, but I'm not completely sold on that, because it spent a lot of time waxing poetic, and then, hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. I'm a planet, so let's go out, maybe.
I don't know. I like the episode with just what it's doing. Yeah, it's not a fit for Dandy. It could probably be something else, but I just I really loved the imagery, and
well, the thing is, I don't like, I like this person thrown in at the last 3 minutes, and that's something the Lolly and the Planet episode both did. The Planet episode is worse for it, honestly.
Yeah, the Lolly episode actually built that relationship throughout the whole thing, so I think that's less egregious.
But the Planet is worse for it, because it threw in the entire point of the episode in the last few minutes.
The main reason why I liked that episode was, like Matt said, the visuals, the animation, and the designs, and just everything about that was awesome, if you ask me. And I liked, like, the scene where those two random aliens talked about that philosophy of, like, death, and they crumbled apart. Like, it was really weird, but it was kind of cool.
Well, that would that's probably also going me and Matt's differences in opinion on the last few episodes of Ava.
And I don't
like it when a show waxes poetic too much.
And I liked how at the end of that episode he actually came back to the planet. Like, that's a parallel universe where Dandy died and decided to stay dead, basically.
For a girl he's known for a grand total of 30 seconds.
I think it was more than just the girl, it was also the other people he'd met on that world. You know.
Not much better.
I guess.
I'm sorry.
I don't know. I don't interact with Moe as much, so I gave it a fly. I don't usually watch that stuff? I guess if you want to,
it's too much Destiny stuff for me. I'm sorry.
Destiny.
And then talking about the plants episode, that's another one that I really didn't like the first time I watched it, but I feel like going back to it when I knew what it was, you know, I was able to appreciate it a little bit more, because that's another one that's, you know, primarily directed and animated by like one guy and had sort of a weird off-model style to it that's kind of unique, you know, a lot of interesting designs. And I kind of liked how at the end it ended kind of darkly with how Dandy, by taking out that stone, caused all the plants to go from sentient plants into normal plants.
Yeah.
It sort of gave a little bit of a gravity to that end moment that I actually kind of like.
Why did I not mention the disco episode?
Oh, that was a good episode.
That was fantastic.
It had more references that you liked.
Oh, yeah.
Because the style differences very much harkened back to old shonen manga and stuff like that. Especially the stills where they just put it in a really sketchy style.
Great Scott,
that booty!
Yeah,
stuff
line.
Like that.
Yeah.
And definitely, alien coming down on a giant UFO disco ball is a concept absurd enough for me.
I'm still looking for that song.
Other things, though. We were treated to King Ghidorah with tits in that episode. And I'm fairly certain one of the other girls was a reference to, like, Doraemon or something else, as far as style goes. There was a lot of really old styles going tossed around that one,
I'm kind of curious that none of you have mentioned the QT Falling in Love episode that was the last one of season one.
I liked it, but nothing to write home about.
Yeah, pretty much. Alex, I think that's probably more a new thing.
I don't know.
Because the base of that episode was also QT falling in love.
I don't know.
Like, I watched it again, and I really dug the giant robot grappling. But going back to what Jeremy said,
the toaster is a reference to Brave Little Toaster.
Oh, yeah. I got that myself, too. The Brave Little Toaster. I get it now. The Brave Little Toaster went to Mars and started a revolution.
Which they, in the original book series.
Yeah.
There is that, and that's actually something that happens in the book. Like, there is this stupid Disney, The Brave Little Toaster Goes to Mars, which is all fantasy.
No.
But if you remember that plot, they were going to nuke the Earth or take it over.
So you're saying that in the book, rather than that fridge being the evil guy, it was the toaster evil?
No. The toaster never went evil. But my point is, the whole idea of they took that concept of appliances from Mars trying to take over whatever, except obviously they weren't Mars here. It was more of just like the giant graveyard or whatever of appliances, but it still had a Brave Little Toaster feel to it.
Yeah, I know.
Just a quick Brave Little Toaster. It's really funny because there's three of the Brave Little Toaster movies. The first one, which I adore. The second one, Brave Little Toaster to Rescue. And then the third one, Brave Little Toaster Goes to Mars. If you were told a book series was made out of this, which one do you think was made out of thin air? You'd probably say Goes to Mars. No. Goes to Mars and the first ones are the ones that have a book adaption. It's the strangest thing.
And I think I've never actually seen the second one in its entirety, but I think that's kind of the worst one of the bunch, isn't it?
The first one you can watch standalone, and it's actually one of my favorite Disney movies.
It's very good.
The other two are they don't stand up.
It's genuinely dark near the end.
I can take
it's
this
genuinely
kind of
dark near the beginning.
Oh yeah, with the air conditioner.
It's not my function.
Okay, I can quote the whole line of the air conditioner. I'm not going to do that for the podcast, but I can quote the whole line. Oh, so it's back to that stupid static again. You don't think I know what goes on in here? I know what goes on in this cottage. It's a conspiracy. And every one of you low watts is in on it. Just because you can move around, you think you're better than I am. I'm not an invalid. I was designed to stick in the wall. I like being stuck in this stupid wall. I can't help it if the kid was too short to reach my dials. Then Toaster goes, we didn't mean it. Really, it's my function.
Boom.
Notice how Matt said he wasn't going to say it in the podcast, and then totally did.
It happened.
Okay. I'm a little impressed.
What are you going to do, Kirby? Suck me to death? Actual line. I'm not making it up.
I've seen that movie too many times.
And one thing I wanted to talk about is apparently at some panel, Watanabe was talking about Space Dandy, and he was basically talking about how in his mind, he's made the same show three times, making these episodic series with small casts of main characters. With Cowboy Bebop, he made a series that focused on drama with a little comedy and action. Samurai Champloo, he made a show that focused on action with a little drama and comedy. And then with Space Dandy, he made a show that focused on comedy with a little drama and action.
Like I said, he was directing a Terror in Residence at the same time. I have a little hard believing. Yes, he did do and write some of the episodes, and he did direct the
I don't think actually he didn't direct any of them. Shingo Natsume directed like the finale and some of the bigger episodes.
My point is, as much as he says, "Oh, my show," I feel like it's one of those cases. No, it's not really your show.
Yeah, and I agree with you. The fact that he was making Zankyo no Terra at the same time, which I think he was heavily involved in, makes me think he was more like he's supervising director. He was more the overseer.
I think when they were working, because obviously, you know, Space Dandy was two core. They call it two seasons, and I'll go with it. But the problem is we knew from the very beginning we were getting 26 episodes. So it's technically just one giant season. But because anime fans like to call a season now 13 episodes.
Yeah. And I wanted to mention that because that's something actually I've started seeing a lot of anime doing. Like Fate Zero did it, where the first half of the show aired. They took a break for a season, which is like 3 months. And
it's
then
honestly,
it came back.
It's just because budgets aren't there anymore.
Well, yeah.
You want to see how it performs. If it's performing up to expectations, you'll give it that better second core, and you kind of hold off on it.
The thing I heard it explained was that during that three-month break, they have time to sell the DVDs from the first half, make some more money, like you said, get more budget to do better animation for the second half. Which, if it makes the second halves better, then
it kind of shows, though, you know, the industry, it doesn't have a lot of money. I mean, everything.
Well,
most of your people go to video games. That's
still
a true fact.
Well, then maybe you should stop pandering to one audience.
You know they're trying, but it's
I did read a few reviews on Dandy, and one interesting thing that they said is that a good thing about Dandy, it's not going to save anime because it's too focused on the Western audience. But the thing is, it is something that appeals to a broader audience than just people who watch anime.
But it reminds you why you love the medium.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It was stuff like this that got me into the medium to begin with.
Yeah, and I talked about this actually on our Kill la Kill podcast from last year. But Dai Sato, who actually wrote a couple episodes of Space Dandy, I believe he's the guy who created Ergo Proxy. And he's written a number of anime over the years.
From what I've heard of Dai Sato, I do like some of the shows he's written. Primarily, I believe he's done El Recca 7. He was a primary writer for that, and also for The Vision of Escaflowne back in the past. Mm-hmm. But most of the stuff he tries now, it does not hold up.
Well, he directed a couple episodes of Dandy, and he was basically saying that one of the reasons he thought Dandy and Kill la Kill were like doing well, or were, you know, one of the reasons they were special was that they sort of harkened back to an older style of anime that didn't focus on plot so much as just being silly and fun and visually stunning.
Well, that's...
I can agree with that with Kill la Kill, too. Mm-hmm. I mean, this isn't the Kill la Kill podcast, but what I'm saying is, yeah, I agree that. I like that shift. Mm-hmm. I like this stuff. And you know what? Maybe we will see in a year or two, because, I mean, it takes a while for, you know, stuff to go through the shoot, focus towards that. I mean, the thing I have to say, Tristan, we see a lot less moe than we used to.
Yeah, it's definitely on the decline, because, like, I'm sorry, Jeremy. Please go ahead.
No, it's fine.
No, go for it.
I was about to say, the reason we're seeing less moe is, unfortunately, a different, equally unpleasant group has taken its place, more or less.
Self-insert.
The self-insert main character. Yes. What I mean by that is, it's a character that is so
coffee,
bland.
Soda, pasta.
Yes. We are in no way implying Sword Arts Online has that kind of character, except it totally does.
I wasn't saying that. I'm just saying it's unfortunately a fairly common trait amongst a lot of the more highly regarded or
popular.
Popular,
at least.
No, you can say better in your opinion.
No, I don't think they're better. Yeah. I don't think they're that. That's the problem. When I watch a show, if I'm not interested in the ongoings of the main character, or the main cast is basically pulling a poochie on me, I don't want
to... I don't know. I can agree with that to an extent, although there are plenty of shows that I like where the main character is probably the least interesting character of the cast,
the
and
main,
the supporting characters are better.
You
know what the difference
is, supposed
though.
To pull you through the story, and if you're not interested in him, then that's...
Or her.
Then that's going to drag the entire thing down. No. The reason I have a problem with those elf inserts, like Jeremy does, is if I don't connect with this, then I'm just watching some schmuck get lucky for 26 episodes
and
while you throw money at it.
Granted, you know what? I'd rather watch a series like you described, Jeremy, you know, like where you care about the main character. A perfect example would be like Morabito. I don't think that had a good ending. I don't like the ending to Morabito, the Secret Spirit Garden, whatever it's called. But Morabito, I don't like the ending of it. But it's got beautiful animation from Production IG, and I genuinely want to find out what happens to Balsa in the end. Do I like what happens? No, But I'll take an I'll take a series where I go on an adventure. Like, I guess you could even say, like, Le Cheval d'Aon.
I've not seen that one, but yeah.
It's, I like it, but it pulls some bull crap near the end. But you know what? I still witness a journey and not self-insert. I'm so cool. I'm so awesome. Get all the ladies.
I guess what, they're less in a moe trend right now and more on an adaptation of light novels trend. And light novels have, because it's written by amateur people and targeted to younger people, has a lot of those very shameless pandery things
true.
In them.
But
it's not all of them.
There are examples, though, of like the power fantasy main character done right, as an example of what we did last week, No Game, No Life, I think
I
does that
I argue against
very well.
Him being a power fantasy because you do not want to be this loser neat who is poorly regarded by most people he's around.
The problem is, I don't, from a standpoint, just a normal consumer of just media in general, I hate power fantasies. I hate them. I hate them. I hate them. They appeal to the least common denominator.
Mm-hmm.
The people they appeal to are the people who look at it and go, "Wow, I can relate to that character because I wish I was as cool as them." And since they don't have a personality or anything resembling one, I can latch on and attach my own personality to them.
It will be a lot harsher towards something that is blatantly a power fantasy.
It is interesting though because you can see the elements of that in a lot of classic really good shows. For example, you know, Star Wars, Luke Skywalker starts as the everyman farm boy who just wants to be, you know, awesome, and then eventually becomes a Jedi Knight, you know, and obviously he is a power fantasy in that you want to be like him because he has awesome powers and things like that.
However, he's not really a power fantasy because it's not just handed to him. He has to develop it, and more often than not, he gets crapped on more than anything else.
Yeah, right. I'm seeing a lot of give, don't earn in some anime protagonists.
But yes, Mahoka, cough, cough.
Yeah.
Please
Mahoka
don't talk about it. I've watched one episode of that. I've never turned off anything.
It was one of the worst episodes when it comes to OPing Tatsuya, I will say. But yeah, that show's pretty
bad. Oh, even worse. Like, I read into some of like the relation things there. That's another thing I've noticed. It seems like back in the day, there was a little more openness towards other cultures in anime. And I feel like
Ghost in the Shell and Akira would probably say otherwise.
Oh, yeah. Well, those are like a couple, but I feel like in general there would be a more diverse cast.
I don't know.
An American appeared, he wasn't always the bad guy.
I don't know. Japan's always been kind of bad with that. And I honestly say they're more so accepting of those sorts of things, especially when you see like Watanabe shows.
I guess,
you know, with Western shows
or talking in anime as bad
about
guys.
The Watanabe element of this. This is something I wanted to bring up. This is no Cowboy Bebop. Space Dandy was originally announced, everyone's like, "Oh, it's a Cowboy Bebop guy.
It's how you hype it.
You hype it. And this is the thing I will say about it, between Space Dandy and Bebop. Bebop is cooler, and I like the themes of Bebop. I think Bebop has definitely the style and the coolness to it. But I would say Space Dandy is more fun than Bebop.
That's true.
And, like, if I had to say a number of episodes that I disliked versus liked, I think there are more duds in Bebop than there are Space Dandy. But, I mean, granted, you are dealing with something completely different. With Bebop, they knew they wanted to do this space opera, you know, a pretty strict follow bounty hunter kind of deal. While Space Dandy was, we're going to kind of open the can of worms and let it squirm out.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to say that it's, I want to basically say they're on par with each other. As far as, like, if we had to compare what the director has done recently, I haven't seen Terror Resonance, but I know it's no Bebop from what I've heard.
It's no Bebop, but it's very good.
It's very good, but I guess my thing is, for me personally, the way I feel about Space Dandy, I would say it's on par with Bebop, but on very different reasons. I would say Bebop, I love the style. I love the tone. There are a few episodes I really just do not care for. There's episode 21 that I can't remember with Jet going on crazy adventures with Chinese girl to find her father. There's also the Ganymede Sea Rat episode that I'm really not a fan of at all. Episode 2, we've talked about this, how like in Space Dandy also shares this trait where the first half of Bebop is not my favorite. The second half of Bebop is more my favorite. I get more episodes out of it.
Yeah, and Space Dandy also picked up in the second half.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the thing is I like when I saw the first season of Space Dandy, I said, yeah, I like some of the episodes. But as I've gone back and rewatched, and like you have, Alex, my opinion's kind of changed. I said, oh, that wasn't as bad. And I think that also helps with the big difference when you were watching Space Dandy is the first season, it was your first time watching it, and it was kind of, well, what am I watching, you know? And then when you got to season two, you were already hyped and ready, like, what are they going to do this time? What crazy thing are they going to do? And you got ready for the crazy.
Well, it was interesting. I saw a thing with the interview with, I think, the Bones president or something, and he said that, like, they held back maybe a little bit with the weirdness or some of the craziness in season one because they wanted to, like, establish an audience. And then season two, they had an audience, so they let the animators go a little more
and
crazy.
And I like that. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Would you agree with that a little bit, Tristan? Not the Bebop thing, but the whole, you know, the first half, and then...
I can definitely agree. I feel like I got more mileage out of the second half, and there was more crazy things done for the sake of doing crazy things.
Yeah, and talking about the Bebop thing, personally for me, I would say I do definitely like Bebop more than Dandy, because I like dramatic stories, you know, a little bit more than the silly ones. I would say I would probably rank Space Dandy above his other really episodic show, Samurai Champloo, which I enjoyed quite a bit, but I think Space Dandy is a bit more memorable and had some really great episodes.
The biggest thing that I would say about Samurai Champloo, have you seen Samurai Champloo, Jeremy?
I've seen most of it.
The biggest issue that I have Samurai Champloo is just the first half is forgettable. They do a recap episode of what happens in the first half of the show. You could cut the first half of the show and really you could cut Samurai Champloo to a 13 episode show. That was my biggest problem. I didn't care with the first 12 episodes. It's just like, I'm watching this because of critical acclaim.
But I think though with Samurai Champloo, it was less plot focused and more like silly action, basically.
I guess what I'm having your problem with Cowboy Bebop, Tristan, mm-hmm. but I had that problem with Champloo. I was watching it because it's like, it's good. I was just not into it. In the second half, I was into it. But I definitely feel that's a Watanabe thing where...
He's more into the dramatic arcs. Like, I can't...
He does a good ending arc. Like,
But it's like, I'm not hating Bebop, but it's definitely... It's pacing. There's not really as much keeping me grounded there as...
Well, like I said,
Space
you've got
Dandy.
The Faye Valentine, the episode where the second episode where they introduce Ayn is okay. Mm-hmm. The pet shopkeeper's a little funny. Like,
well,
my baby!
Kind of like you were saying, I was actually going through and looking at like what my favorite episodes of Bebop were, and most of them are in the second half.
Yeah.
Like, the one we're about to get to in J-Con is Mushroom Samba, which is one of the funniest episodes of the show.
Only because Ayn is a corgi, and he goes... Beep, beep, beep,
exactly.
Beep, beep.
So, to wrap up our discussion, let's talk a bit about the finale, because that's what prompted this podcast, because the finale was basically a 10 out of 10 episode.
I could go on such a fanboy rant on this final
episode.
Oh,
yeah. I've actually watched the ending episode two times after this, like, mm-hmm. in the background. Like, not, like, full attention watching. And it's just amazing to see... I think no one was expecting the B's betrayal, and I love that. And actually, in Jeremy's favorite episode, episode 9 with the library, with the library, that's when B actually takes control of the situation. Do you remember?
Yeah. Well, I was watching that episode, and you saw B be more serious, and he was like, you know, curse you, Dandy, like in a more serious voice.
It's interesting. It kind of hints that he can be this way, and I like
that he can be this way.
Ah. And something else, you notice in the last few episodes, they really start talking about like this parallel universes thing, like with the episode with the 2D universe, or, you know, the episode before, the courtroom episode talking about the Pionium. Like, they start building it up a little bit more, you know, making you think about these things.
Yeah, but I mean, I would even say the Pionium thing would be like, that would also exist with the episode 2, the space ramen. The whole idea that guy with his ramen, it's coming through a different dimension.
Yeah, and in the QT episode, Pionium is what hits QT to make him grow huge. Like,
and
you
then
see
Pionium
it show up.
Hits the calendar and Groundhog Day loop.
Yeah, yeah. But I bring up the ramen one because that one wasn't alert. Like, when they talked about the Pionium things, they didn't show all the examples. They showed some of the newer ones in season 2, but mm-hmm. there were examples in season 1, obviously, like when QT got large, mm-hmm. but also the whole ramen thing, because they offered to take him back, but he wouldn't have remembered anything because... Granted, there is the whole thing. Well, Meow went through the thing too.
I think it was because it was a wormhole. But he did mention that his ramen doesn't taste the same when it goes through the wormhole because it's not the same ramen.
Yeah. So, I don't know. I would attribute that weirdness of that wormhole existing to Dandy's existence as well. I mean,
yeah,
freaky ramen dimension.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things I love the most about this show is just as somebody who's, because I've started research more into like animation quality, you know, and like sakuga, which is like basically a term used, it means key animation in Japanese, but it's also a term used by American fans to talk about just really good looking animation. Like you'd be watching an episode of an anime, it looks totally normal, and then this one part looks really good because it was done by this really good animator. Space Dandy is basically a playground full of that, and the last episode was basically nonstop awesome animation done by a bunch of different people.
Can I just tell you how freaking excited I was when okay, so we've seen Johnny's giant robo like three times through the series. The first time he curb stomps the big core thing, the second time he's just landing at the thing, in the final episode we finally get to see the giant robot into big core actually have like a no holds barred fist match and the lion thing
it's
coming out of his
chest. It's basically a giant unicorn face and fire truck robot.
Yes, I know, and they're just going at it, and I love it. And then the Statue of Liberty thing, like...
That was funny. That was hilarious.
I read up on the design notes, because I think you linked me to an article on one of the designers for Space Dandy, where there was no reason that he was piloting a giant gagged Statue of Liberty at first. He just designed it that way because he thought it would be funny. And then the final episode, they decide to just give it an entire body, and then it throws... He's piloting the Statue of Liberty into the giant death machine, and then the Statue of Liberty throws off her towels, and she's wearing, like, Valkyrie bondage gear underneath it, and it's
so
ridiculous.
What was it called?
Pionium?
No, the machine, the device.
Oh, I don't know. Death machine.
the super hyper collider or something.
Well, it was called the Horagon. And then I like in that episode, he's like, correction, the super collider, whatever it was called.
Oh, yeah. And Admiral Perry. I want to bring up Admiral Perry. I tried looking up Google's founder. It turns out Google's founder's name is Larry.
That's kind of funny. And I also kind of liked how it turned out that thing we'd been saying of the skull with the universe cape that all the time was just an illusion. It was just some dude.
He was just some old dude with white hair and a business suit. Hey, probably what the actual Google founder looks like.
Damn it, there was something I was going to say.
They're probably coming for me. They'll come for me in my sleep.
Oh, I was curious what, because I didn't get to watch it with all you guys, because I actually came home in the middle of while you were watching the final episode from the podcast. But there's a very, very, very obvious Evangelion reference with the tree thing that
he's... The tree of life that he's on, and then the whole... Well, the part where B has the gun, that is the same exact part when
Didn't they even blank out one of B's lines? I don't think they did. No, but it was when Gendo shot Ritsuko and was telling him something. Yeah, it was like a shot for shot. It was good. I also want to put special notice to when Dr. Gel grabbed B.
He was enormous.
Yes, they just like threw out all sense of size and just like.
They did what like Gamagori does.
Yeah,
and,
that's what I thought.
And
of.
I like that. That's it's one of those things you're doing it for animation's sake, not for
right.
The other thing I liked about the, we already had the Shining reference with the, here's Johnny. Mm-hmm. But the other thing that I also enjoyed was the whole Star Wars, like, when they were flying
the trench run.
The trench run. I really liked that.
And we got to see the Dandy Robo again.
Yeah. And
which we noticed the pompadour on it this time.
Yeah.
And then the fact, as we talked about, that the narrator is basically, turns out, was God the whole time. And he offers God to Dandy and he kicks it away to be, because he wants to go
Dandy,
to boobies.
Stop. What are you doing? He has no enunciation. He has, like, such a blank expression.
And Dandy was even like, haven't I heard your voice before? He's like, yes, as a Chameleonian and as the narrator.
They tied it up really well.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it.
With the parallel universes. Like, it made everything kind of make sense in a way that doesn't really make sense because Dandy doesn't make sense.
That's what that ending credits sequence when they showed all the stuff. Mm-hmm. If you go back and watch that and you watch a random episode, you'll go, oh, that's from that. Like, they included almost every, like, something from each episode.
Oh, yeah.
To tie it. Like, there was a drive-in movie theater. That's from the very last scene I forgot about in the zombie episode, apparently.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
no,
yeah.
I saw that. They were even they were playing the episode on the screen, too.
Because they watched George Romero, Night of the Living Dead at the end of the episode.
Yeah, by the end, they claimed that that episode was directed by George Romero.
Exactly. Final thoughts on Space Dandy. Personally, for me, there are a few bad episodes, as you would get with a show that's so episodic and so crazy as Space Dandy. I honestly think Space Dandy is probably the most creative anime I've ever seen in that because it had so many different directors and writers and animators working on it, like even animators and designers and stuff from not in Japan.
I guess the thing you would add to that, it's the most creative. We want to be wacky, goofy, and crazy.
And draw
but
movies.
It, But it all ties together. I think that's the crucial thing, because you can have a bunch of people being wacky, goofy, crazy, but if it doesn't add up, then it's just a pile of mess. And I think that's what they did well.
But at the same time, I feel like it was nice that the 26th episode tied things together, but if it had just been a cool final battle, it ended, and every episode was still kind of a standalone thing, I still would have enjoyed Space Dandy.
I still would have enjoyed it, but I think the fact that they said that almost every, you know, the dandy that was you as a surfer, the dandy that was you as a truck driver, the dandy, you know, they basically mentioned, the truck driver one was from one of the alternate dandies that they met in episode 14, but...
The dandy that was the depressed guy in the ball pit.
Emo dandy.
Photoshop emo dandy on everything.
Oh, yeah. I've seen. I love that image with the DashCon Tumblr pit.
They just put him in the middle of
But yeah, but just that craziness of creativity combined with really strong production budgets, you know, and great animation and likable characters, all that led to Space Dandy really being, like, probably in, like, my top 30 anime. Like, it's not as good as Cowboy Bebop for me, like I said, but
Alex,
I still really
enjoyed
it.
Alex, you always say it's in your top 30 anime.
Always. Everything is in my top 30 anime. Yeah. Jeremy, what are your final thoughts?
It's okay. 9 out of 10.
9 out of 10. All right.
Short and concise.
Matt.
We've already, I've already kind of expressed my views that I do like it probably equal or... I don't want to say better than Bebop, but I want to say, yes, it's more fun. It's a more fun show. And one thing that I've appreciated it in the lineup. I've appreciated hanging out with people saying, let's get together and watch this episode of Dandy.
In a way, we haven't really had that since we all watched Toonami with our friends after school.
Right. I mean, and that's, I guess it was a good show that was in the thing that I loved about it most. You never knew what you were getting. You got a curve. It was like you're going up to bat and you don't know what you're going to get. What ball? It's going to be curve, strike, ball.
So would
whatever.
You say then if it's on the equal level to Bebop, it's probably in like your top 10, like one of your all time favorites.
I don't know. I mean, because, for example, the Big O. I love the Big O, the first season at least. I still appreciate the second. Mm-hmm. I love the music of the Big O. I'm actually working on an animated thesis thing that's referencing the Big O quite a bit. Like, I make a lot of references to it, but I wouldn't say the Big O's in my top 10. Like, I don't know if I want to. Does that make sense? Like,
yeah.
I super enjoy the show. I think that's one of those. I guess you might want to have like a list of guilty pleasures where it might not be the best show,
like favorites versus best.
I think that's it, and I think Dandy is easily one of my favorites of anime. I think that's the best way. Like, Big O and Dandy, I love them. I don't know if I'd put them on a top 10, but I put them. They're definitely my favorites.
The thing is, even if I did have a top 10, I would have to sit and ruminate on Dandy a little more before I would consider it.
Well, you need to finish it.
Well, yeah, but I basically saw most of it. Like, there was only a handful, barely even a handful that I missed. The thing is, like, shows like this and Kill la Kill that are putting a lot of passion into animation while also keeping the story and everything enjoyable and open to more people. I am liking this pattern. I would like to see more of it.
I want to see more of this pattern, too. It's just...
I'm not sure if we will, because...
Kill la Kill was very successful.
Mm-hmm.
Dandy, I don't know how successful it was.
Yeah.
I guess
Dandy was more of a Western thing.
Yeah,
by
which
far.
Is why I wanted to say to any listeners out there who have enjoyed Space Dandy, it would be worth it to support Dandy when the DVDs and Blu-rays come out because it is really relying on the Western audience to make its money.
I mean, but the thing is Funimation gets that money. I mean, a portion of it goes back to Japan, but
the thing is, no matter who gets the money, it will show that this is a lucrative thing that people like, you know.
True, and you know what? I mean, if we get a Dandy movie, great. That's what that's been, you know, Dandy movie or OVA, that's what's been hinted. Will there probably be another TV series? Probably not.
I think an OVA is probably likely, a movie less so, but we'll see.
Definitely what the successes have, kind of like Bebop, this is far from the last we'll be seeing of Dandy. Another series, probably a stretch, but we'll definitely see more of Dandy.
You'll see a movie. Bebop got a movie like 2 or 3 years after it was done. And I really love the Cowboy Bebop movie. You want a good action flick? You watch the Cowboy Bebop movie.
Yeah, but I guess I guess my own final thoughts. I love my Dandy, and I love the booty. Stay dandy, everybody.
All right.
Booties in the booby.
Good way to finish it off. So next week, listeners, you can join us to hear us talk about Code Geass as we scheduled.
Let's douche the rebellion.
I'd rate Code Geass not dandy out of 10.
Yep.
Not dandy out of 10.
So thank you guys for being here. I know for Matt and Jeremy, it's been a while since you've been on the podcast, so it's nice to have you back. For those of you who enjoy listening.
I'm still working on my thing.
I'm closer. Are you talking about your, like, YouTube thing?
Yeah, I've got a...
Okay, he's working on it. For those of you who enjoyed this podcast, you can email us at techeds@avwproductions.com. You can follow us on Twitter at techeds.ou. Like us on Facebook. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Give us good ratings and reviews. We've got a blog at techeds.me. All sorts of cool stuff. So thank you very much for listening, and we will see you guys next time.
Stay dandy, everybody.
This product is copyright AVW Productions 2014.